Welcome, 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 you people watching on YouTube while other people are getting to the live stream. I will, I'll show you what's been done since yesterday. So if you were following along, wrote this thing to, this is called a behavior tree. And what this does, it allows AI to actually be really smart and all data driven. So check it out. I'm gonna run this game now with this data-driven AI for the dropped enemy. The dropped enemy is the one with the cow skull head. And now if I'm near him, he charges me. They're like much more intelligent enemies. So like I can get just worked by these guys really fast. And they're a lot more difficult to fight. There, I'm already dead. So, and they're not, they don't even have that strong of an attack either. So, that's with them at the full intelligence. So, the way that intelligence works is that each one of these sequences, or you call it, these are nodes or leaves in a tree. This is the behavior tree. As I step down into tabs around here, that gets farther down in the tree. And then there's this one right here, if ran smart. What this does is it checks, all of these ifs check something. And then if ran means it compares a random number between 0 and 1 versus something else. You could go if ran 0.5, that means half the time it will do the rest of the things in the sequence. And then this one, in this case, if ran smart means it does a random roll versus the AI's intelligence. So I'm setting up these guys with full intelligence. That's 100% intelligence right there. If I set them to 0, run it again, they're going to be at full dumbness. I can sit right by them and watch them just walk right by me. So you'll see. Oh, that guy got lucky. You see there, I'm really close to this guy. He has no clue I'm even there. He's very unaware. Look, he's going to walk right by me. That's because he has no intelligence. So all of his intelligence rolls go below that smartness factor. So if you put it on like, you know, 25%, you're going to get a little more of intelligence. And then, so what's great is I can work all of that into this data-driven AI now. And that is just, it's so awesome. Thank you for the suggestions yesterday. Or thanks to the people watching the stream yesterday, that was one of their suggestions, was why don't you make this your own file format? I tried doing a property list, and that was just really problematic and horribly hard to actually write. And then I tried JSON. That again was, you know, just too structured. And then this is just way more simple. All it is tabs to just select the depth of the tree, and new lines to get to the next node in the tree. So today the goal is to actually change all of the AI in the game over to this new system. Right now the AI is currently working with the old system and the new system. So there's an existing AI system which worked on moods, which is the only way I really have done AI for the last many years. And now that I've got this new system is based on behavior trees, I'm very excited to go move the other AI and try out some other things in adding it to this nice new AI system. So also today, I've got the new Songbringer website finished. So this is songbringer.com. It's a Tumblr blog, and it's got a few things up here, and it's also got the story. So the story of Songbringer, you can check it out if you're into that, into this game. So there's that. And also I'm going to be checking this forum post I just did on TIGSource, because I just posted this a second ago, and I'm excited to share it finally on TIGSource with other people. So let's get into actually doing this AI and making some more, converting over more of the AI. So first thing I want to do is create a blob AI. So this is going to be similar to the drop. And so if they're stuck, Choose a random direction. Set your speed to 1. Yes. This chooses a target. So if the AI has no target and it's smart, it will target the nearest hero. Charge, this is one thing I'm probably, well, yeah, I guess I could do something like this. If ran smart, target in a line, speed 2. I really do want to make this a bit unique though. So sequence seek, if ran smart, if ran forward, dir towards the target. So I'll make them wander a bit more. So I'm going to set the random bit down. So when they're wandering or when they do a random roll, they'll do a lot more randomness there. So I'm going to set their random slow factor a bit higher and their random fast factor a bit lower. And then yeah, this is actually a pretty good AI to start with. I'm excited to actually write all these AIs so that I can creatively make them a little bit more unique. And adding more features to this new behavior tree is going to help. So call this the blob. The next thing I'm going to do is hook up the which behavior is being loaded from the property list. So the drop right here can go attributes behavior drop.txt. Blob. I'm just going to set this to behavior blob.txt. Same thing for blob 2. The bomb's going to have its own unique one. I'm going to need to write that. Butterfly is very simple, but unique AI. Crow. Okay, so droid A. Droid bat. Eve is the same thing. Fire. That's not even an AI. Jib. Okay. He'll have his own AI. Pulverizer. That's going to be a pretty easy one to write. Rock. Squirrel. Top hat. Wisp. The wisp will have the same AI for now. Okay, so now I'm going to go hook that up. So in when I'm loading the AI, it's actually going to grab the name of the behavior, profile, profile.default attribute for key. I'm going to grab its behavior as a string. And now, instead of this hard-coded bit right here, I can go if behavior.size, then use this AI component style where we're doing behavior. And then otherwise, it'll use the old AI. Actually, we might not even need that because now we've done all the enemies. So when we're creating an AI component, I want to make sure to take off this text because I'm using that. Okay, so now that should work. Should load all these behaviors. All right. Oh, I forgot I set all of the enemies to load their type as the dropped enemy. So there we go. Now we can do some unique enemies for every screen. And we'll take off the world code mega seed here. So next time it'll do a random world. So I'm gonna put all enemies at actually I'm gonna set up an intelligence factor right now. So I'm gonna go float intelligence equals area pause dot z over 1.0. So the area pause is gonna be 1. This is gonna give you 10% intelligence for enemies on this first level here. So this enemy is going to be a nice one to customize. This one will be easy to do as well. Okay, I'm going to check and see if that boss is still functioning, at least moving around. That's all we really need to check. Yep, she's working. She's moving around. It's weird. I just killed her, but she stayed. Oh, that's right. I added some new stuff that makes enemies permanent on the screen. Okay, so that's great. That AI is still doing its thing. Now, I really want to start doing some more AI and... Actually, I think I will start with those pulverizer enemies. They look like meat grinders. So I'm saving that world code I just did so I can, because I'm pretty sure the first room had the pulverizers. Oh no, that is the bats. Okay, so this room has pulverizers. I'm going to set my room to there. That was 1 over 1 up. Okay, there we go. Now I'm going to start in that room, and now I can draw some cool pulverizers and also do a pulverizer AI. So we'll start with the regular AI I've already got here. Now, sequence. Okay, what I want the pulverizers to do is just like in several games, but particularly The Legend of Zelda, there's these traps that trigger as soon as you get near them, and they like slide shut. So That is going to be okay. So if they get stuck, that means they haven't moved. They're going to go in the opposite direction. Okay, so I need to add, whoops. Put this in assets, behaviors. It's going to be called the pulverizer. And I'll hook it up. Pulverizer plist is going to use the pulverizer behavior. Now, so I need this, what's called this is a keyword, I need opposite. So none nearest opposite. Start compiling that. And then in there's a nice little map I've made here of words to integers, K behavior. Opposite is going to be the word opposite. So the parser uses that to load it. And then in the system, I'm going to add the word. Oh, it's right here. Great. So rand is like that. This is going to be now the word opposite. So if k behavior opposite in the setting of the dir, then it's going to be opposite compass dir. Okay, so while that's compiling, oh, we got a failure. What's up with that? Oh, we gotta pass in e dot AI editor. And oh, why doesn't opposite? It's opposite compass direction. Okay, so there, if so this pulverizer, if it gets stuck, it's going to go in the opposite direction at a slow speed. So there's that will set its target. So if it's going to choose if target is none, target the nearest hero. Sequence charge. This is a what we call a sequence trap. If this is a if always. So if target is in a line, speed is going to be 2 times what it normally is. The direction is towards the target. No delay. That's it. It'll start moving towards the hero, but only in a straight line. Seek, no, this doesn't need this anymore. Wander, doesn't wander. Speed, this doesn't don't need this. Stop, don't need that. Forget, don't need that. This is a really simple AI. Okay, there, we got the pulverizer AI written. Now let's see if it even works. It should spring the trap closed if I'm near it. Okay, what's up? Why are they wandering around and stuff? Let's figure this out. So, is there any reason why this guy would wander? We've got dir opposite and dir target. That's it. And I'm pretty sure the pulverizer plist set up to run that. Okay. I'm gonna go check what is being loaded for this enemy. Okay. So I can see into this method here. We've got the AI component loaded. Nothing should be in its behavior. Now we're parsing the behavior. String stream. Let's see if that is correct. I don't know. Data. There, we should be able to see into the data. Man, I can't. All right, anyways. Data should be visible. Okay, there it is. Sequence select, stuck, dir opposite. Yeah, this does appear to be this very simple AI. Well, you always get little problems at first with every new system. So, okay, so this, the thing is to figure out why the heck are they, why are they wandering around? They're supposed to only be in certain positions. In fact, I'm going to make sure that they are only in the corners. That would be a good first step. So if R equals, well, let's just do if profile name is, pulverizer, then we're going to set a positions in the corner. And if R, we don't need to do this so many times. We're doing this, only need to do this once. There. Now we can do if profile name equals pulverizer. I want to only do four of these kind of enemies. So n equals 4. Here we go. There, now we even got a size. All right, so now when we're setting up these pulverizers, 0 is going to be in the top left, or let's say bottom left. So switch I case 0. We're going to do X position. X of 1. I think these are based. Oh, those aren't tiles. Here we go. So it's X plus a half, Y plus a half. So I'm going to do 1.5. And then tile size dot height times, oh, I don't know, 1.5? I'm not sure exactly. Might be 2.5. So break. Okay, now we got 1, 2, 3. Tile size dot width. This is going to be tile size dot height times height minus 2 or 3. I'm going to try 3.5 at first. Same thing there. And then these are going to be width minus 1.5. I think width minus 1.5. Okay, I'll run this, and that should place them in the four corners. And then we'll get into animating them, making them really cool, and making sure the AI is working too. I'm not sure why these guys are wandering at all. Maybe they don't have targets. Oh, cool. Oh, great. That worked. Great. I'm glad I put them in the corners on the first try. Except for these two can be 2.5 minus the height. Nice. All right. They all started in the right place. If only they weren't these crazy AI. They're acting exactly like the other AI do. It's almost like it's running the wrong behavior, but I saw that it was loading the right one, so. I'm going to set the actual R. I'm going to set the R to 3, guaranteed, and find a different screen for them to be on. Because I want to use a screen that randomly generates with the bottom open. There's one. Okay, so one more screen up. That's gonna be in the world. I wanna set the starting position, the Y of 2. So good, now we've got a good screen to work with. Now it's a matter of figuring out why they're running this crazy AI. And secondly, making them look cool. Making them do a really cool big old screen shake when they hit each other and everything. So, first thing, I'm gonna make just one enemy. So I can debug it. Now I'm gonna go into the actual system for running a behavior. I'm gonna figure out why the heck it's doing what it's doing. It's gonna break when I get that far into the AI. All right. So first thing I'm gonna do, okay, it's running an if. It should be, if stuck, dir opposite. I wonder if this one is actually the one that's messing it up. You know what? The first thing I want to check is if it starts with its own direction already set. If it does have a direction, then I guess that this AI would really mess up fast. Okay, so it does have a direction, none. Stuck. Oh, it might start stuck. That would also okay. This X is 3000. Okay, so this is true. It's starting out in the stuck position. So this makes sense. So what is it going to do next? Let's see. It's going to, I guess it would set the direction to opposite. Let's see. Behavior target. Direction, here we go. None, ran, target, opposite. So e.ai.dir equals opposite compass direction. So what is this going to do if it has no compass direction? Here's our bug. So it's setting up a direction immediately right there. So if dir equals k dir none, return k dir none. Here we go. That ought to fix the whole AI. Let's see. Because what it was doing is it was giving it a direction right away. And then it just kind of got into its flow of moving around. I don't know how it would get so many different directions out of that, though. Oh, it would definitely target me. Okay, that's what I was doing. I was getting near it. I was in a line with it, so that's why the AI did what it did. Oh, come on. You can move now. Go ahead. All right, he's not moving at all now. Doesn't like it. Okay, here's what we need to do. We need to make sure that the direction is exactly Zeth. Exactly. That's exactly what I was just about to say. That if like dir is none, basically, or if dir is not none, basically, something like that. So there's a couple ways I can write that. And writing it really flexibly will be important here. So, and welcome to the stream, Zeth. No, I don't want to do a random direction if it is none, because I want these guys to only move in a straight line towards the target. There are traps that spring shut. So I've already got if dir. I think I got if dir. Let's see if. Yeah. If Okay, no, I haven't even implemented anything about directions. Okay, I got it. I'm gonna go if dir any. So that means anything but none. And so I need to add the word any. So none, any. Add this to the component. Okay, and then add this into the system. So we need the ability for the if there is, if subtype equals k behavior dir, now if subtype 2 is k behavior none, then return e dot ai dot dir equals k dir none, and then if subtype 2 is any, then return anything but none. Dir, oh, it's not equal to none. There is dir. Else, okay, so we've got one more thing we can do to make this system really cool. We can do if subtype 2 is greater than k dir south and subtype 2 is less than or equal to, sorry, these are both should be equal to subtype k dir southeast, return e.ai.dir equals subtype 2. And that might complain. I guess it's not going to complain about those being compass directions and not integers. So dir south is 0, dir southeast is the last one in that sequence. So there, we can actually compare it to any direction at all, anything that's none, or any of the actual directions which are already hooked up as w, n. Oh, let's see. Nope, I guess it worked. Oh, but I don't want them to be able to do that. Okay, these work. Yeah, in this case, he actually had a direction already. So, okay. So I want him now. The AI, I want it to be able to not, if targeting the line, if dir none. It's there. It can only spring the trap if it doesn't have a direction at that point. So, going there. Because there's no on a, oh, I don't know why he did that. He's supposed to turn around. Oh, because what, he didn't get stuck. So there's an automatic, in the engine, there is an automatic bit which, does kind of like a quasi pathfinding. So what was happening is he got to that edge, the pathfinding started him moving up along that edge because his vector was in that direction. So the best thing I think is to make enemies get stuck when they move. So really the only person that should be able to do the quasi pathfinding is the player. Quasi pathfind. Or e.ai. is empty, not empty. There we go. Now, so if it has an AI, it's never going to pathfind. It's not real pathfinding, it's just quasi-pathfinding. So if the player gets, like, walks across something, he walks automatically around it. There, now come on, hit that other edge and turn around. Nice! Okay, it's not moving fast enough. The trap should be way faster than that. Boom, cool. Okay, now we just gotta make him faster and make him look cooler and put more of them in here. Thanks for all your help, Zeith, this week. Great, great advice and stuff. I just posted my game on TigSource, so I'm stoked to finally actually have a post on there. And I just finally finished the website too, songbringer.com. It's got the story for the game, the actual story behind the characters and everything too. So, let's see. So we wanna make four of them. There, that's done. Now, what was the next step? Make them faster. So, oh, that's a good thing. I really want to put the speed into the profile. So let's do that. Pulverizers, speed. Let's see. It's currently 45 for most enemies. So pulverizer, I want to move way faster than that. So speed. Do I have a parse vector yet? Let's see. Parse vector, I do. Nice. Val 1, Val 2. Cool, so I can actually program this properly. Or I mean, set this data like this. So pulverizer data, it's speed. I'm gonna try like 120 by 100. So 100 and it's Y speed, because this is a slightly tilted angle for the game. So then I'm gonna go and move into doing int x speed x speed y. Speed x is 45, speed y default is 45 times 0.9. What's that? 40 or 41. There we go. Now we'll read from string speed equals this speed. If speed dot size. Parse vector. Oh, that's kit parse vector. So kit parse vector. Come on. You know parse vector? I just saw that. Yeah, it definitely has this function. All right. Xcode's lying to me. Parse vector. Speed, and then I think this is speed X, speed Y. What was the last bit? Delimiter. Delimiter's comma. Now if speed X, wait, does that automatically? Oh yeah, we already checked if that actually has a value. So as a string, there we go. And then this bit can now be speed X, speed Y. There, now if we have regular enemies, they'll be at 45, 41, or if they don't have that in their profile yet, and these guys should be faster. Oh yeah, that's cool. Oh, that's kind of funny. They got off on their rhythm. Hmm. So one of them must have been doing something in its AI that the other wasn't. Wait, why are you guys just bouncing? Okay. Here, we'll do this. We need to set its target to none if it bounces. So target in a line. Oh, if stuck, dir opposite, target none. So this is going to be another, we'll call this one finished. So if stuck, dir any, if target none, dir none. So if target is none, if dir is none, target nearest. There, I think that's what it'll do. Yeah, totally. I mean, this is all a behavior tree is. Just basically scripting AI. It's really cool to write it this way because the old AI took so many functions and different things, and this one is much more simple. Okay, so they didn't stop that time. Yeah, okay, so the other stop needs to get stopped. Okay, so this one is sequence. Call this one bounce. If stuck, dir any, dir opposite, target none, speed one. Okay, so if this target is none, if dir is none. So why is it not finishing? If stuck, dir any, target none, dir none. Yeah, definitely. I was going to write that last night. I've already got that in there. Yeah, I do have the ability to do text, and I have the debug switch I can turn on so everybody has text above their heads, but it's written for my old system of moods, so I do need to kind of like do that, like what is it doing right now? Actually, that's what should be done for sure, because I'm not sure at all what the heck is going on, so first step, debug for sure. Good call, Z. So I'm going to turn that system on. And then start figuring out how to draw that. So, I think it's just going to be as simple as setting the label. I know, right? It's hard for me to tell too. I don't know what's going on. So visually, we need to know. Here's the bit that sets the old way of doing it. Now I just need to put in some stuff that I think the best way to do it is we're going to be right here in the selects and the sequences. That will be the only thing which does any kind of visual debugging. So if kdraw debug, we're going to do e.render.label set string. We'll use kit Git string with format. This is going to be, this is sequence percent s, and that's going to be this current behavior values 0.cstr. No, dot as string dot cstr. And then all of this is going to be if b.values.size. And then the same thing for the selects. If the select succeeds, it will show what was selected. I think that should give a good indicator of what it did. The last, like, overall section of the AI code that it ran. Okay, so it's running moods. Oh, there, good. Sequence trap, sequence bounce. Okay, good. Very good, that worked. So we got sequence trap, sequence bounce. Okay, so they're just bouncing back and forth. They're not doing, what was it called? It was supposed to go... Okay, so it did trap, it did bounce, but then it was supposed to go... Oh, bounce. Okay, that's it, right there. Bounce needs to check if it has a target, if target any. So we need to do, we need to make sure also that targets can be compared to any in their if. If target is any. So if k behavior any, if e.a.i.target is greater than zero, it's going to be called any target. Sequence trap, sequence bounce. Yeah. Sequence choose. All right. Good. Okay, now one last thing. Might be helpful to list target plus dir. Yeah, good call. Very, very good call, actually. Those are the other two very, very helpful things that would be nice to add. Great suggestion. So we're going to do... I'm going to shorten this to the SEQ, SEL... And actually, I can just do both percent %d's for these without having to do any kind of just extra labeling for that. So e.ai.dir and e.ai.target. Wait, let's see. Oh, those are just, I can just cast these as... Oh. There we go. All right, get these parentheses lined up. Yeah, this is turning out to be a really good system. I'm loving it so much. I'm like so stoked to write AI now because I can see visually really clearly what's going on. Okay, there, it did. So that guy, that first guy got his started faster than the other guy. So they got off a little bit. I guess it doesn't matter now that they stop. I'm curious though how that one little situation happened where the one where they got off their rhythm. Oh, he's there. Well, how did that happen? That guy went, the other guy didn't. Oh, because he's Oh, because one of them is way in the corner and the other one is not quite all the way in the corner. All right, so that's just simply making their collision boxes bigger. So I'm going to do that also in the property list. So the property list here, this is going to be called size, and it's going to be, this guy's the same as a tile, which is 20 by 12. So back in area when we're creating these guys. Actually, all of these can be done up here. Nope. Eventually, I'm going to need to do different AI in each one of these. So, let's see. We're going to do, we grab the size. And parse it. Actually, I'm going to do a parse vector, which is floats. Or actually, a vector. That'd be way better. So we got another function to add here, parse vector into a vector. Constring vec2v. Then we can just go int x. Oh no, I don't want these to be ints. I want these to be floats. V dot x equals. Do I have parse float? Parse float. I guess I do. Awesome. Stir to F. That's the good function to use. Cool. All right. V dot x is that one. V dot y is this one. If lems dot size equals just one. V dot x, V dot y. What's up, Fade Sword? How you doing? Also, this is a parse float. There, and we've got a nice parse vector function, which we don't need to, it's not going to be as cumbersome to use these other methods. So this is going to be if size string dot size, then kit parse vector into size. But I think that's going to give me an error. Yeah. Because I need one more method. Kit dot h parse vector. I want to do another one, which is parse size. Fade Sword, if you've seen this game before, wait. True roguelikes is a skill based, or the ones that have already been released a lot lately that are luck based. That's a good question. I'm not exactly sure the answer to that because it's really more of like a Zelda-like. It's not really a true roguelike in the sense that roguelikes are, they're turn-based usually. The really the true roguelike quality to this game is it's procedurally generated. So it's kind of like a more of like a procedurally generated Legend of Zelda than it is a true roguelike. So I'm not sure whether this question about whether it's based on luck or skill. I guess it would be made more based on skill because it's real time. So I hope that answers your question. So now we got this parse size, so we don't need to do. Here we go. A size string parse size. And then we can make sure I've already got that in that guy's profile, so that's good. So now they should have a bigger size when they're in the game. And when they spring shut and fly back, oh, I forgot to write that. We're just going to use the other parse vector function and then put it into a size stir. No, not this one. V delim delim. And then size.width equals v.x. Size.height equals v.y. There we go. You don't like that, do you? Oh. S. There. Okay, so they're still not bigger. Oh, and suddenly the player can't even move. That's weird. Many turn-based roguelikes normally means require insane skill and it's completely unforgiving. Oh, cool. Yeah, a lot of roguelikes these days aren't turn-based as much anymore. Okay, so what the heck happened there? So I'm gonna not do this. Okay, I see one mistake I made here. I'm supposed to parse the size string. There. Okay, I'm still stuck. This is so weird. Yeah, they have changed a lot. Okay, so, oh, I know what it is. All right, it's changing the size of the entire level because I named this variable pretty inappropriately. Call it size. I shouldn't have named something so universal, such a simple name. Where is that size at? It's just S. Okay. So I'm going to parse that into S. There we go. Now the level will be the proper size. I'll be able to run around. And hopefully these guys, when they hit the walls, and they bounce back. Yeah. Okay. The only problem is these guys in the top left and right, they didn't get set up correctly because they, let's see, I'm going to turn debugging off. And what's wrong with their position? It's either the X or the Y. Oh, it's right here. Okay, I think it's gonna be the top two, which are these two heights. So I'm gonna start with moving the height down. Okay, so the guy on the right. Both of them on the right were too far to the right, so move them back just a couple pixels. Because their collision is actually colliding with the walls there at first, and it's automatically giving them a position. Okay, there we go. Now heights, instead of 2.5, try this one at 1.6 or 2.6. I'm trying both at 1.6 now. Even just a pixel overlapping onto the wall will actually cause the code to move in. Okay, I want them to tuck themselves up in that corner there, so. Right. Nice. Oh, and it's great that they're not hitting me right when I first walk into the room. So what if I walked up to the north? Awesome. So there is a tiny little gap kind of built into these levels where I can walk across and not get hit by these guys. Awesome. That's really great. Okay, so now what I want to do is I want them to shake the screen when they collide. So I want to do a screen effect. Finish bounce. Here we go. Let's bounce. Speed one. Oh yeah, this is it. Okay, speed one and then screen shake 0. Oh. That's just going to be a big screen shake. So screen shake 5. So now we need two new words added to the AI system. We need screen and shake. Behavior screen, behavior shake. I don't know if I'm going to get any replies on this thread. Maybe I got buried. It's not yet buried, but nobody's replied yet. Huh. Well, you know, eventually people probably will. Okay, so we got screen, we got shake, those are building. Okay, so I gotta add these into the component so those words are recognized. Screen. What's up, Vesvon? Please, yeah, that'd be nice. I'd like to have at least one reply. It'd be so nice. But, you know, you don't have to say anything like, you know, just say whatever you want, whatever you would say. You don't have to be super nice or anything. So screen, shake. Cool, got those working. Nice, gun tower. Gun tower I've never played. Let me see that one. Gun tower. Nice. What is this supposed to represent, huh? Is it Tower of Guns you're talking about? So now we just gotta hook up this screen and the shake. So this is gonna be cool. AI is gonna be able to shake the screen with their scripts. Yeah. That's crazy if you can do 18 jumps in a row. Okay, now if type is K behavior screen. Oh, yeah. So we got if behavior screen, then if subtype equals K behavior shake, then we're going to grab the second variable. Let's see. No, we're going to need to. Right here, we'll make sure that we have that many values. So what's cool is every, let's see, every behavior is parsed into now into a type, and then a vector of values, and then a vector of its children. So what's great is any bit of this scripts could have as much data as they wanted. I could be like 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can just keep going and going and going, use as many as I wanted. So but really, all we want to do is just one value there. So I want to make sure this has at least one value, two values, because we've got one value is shake, the next one is that 5 right there, and then we're going to do a screen shake. We'll do this, and B values get type is float. What's up, Kadao? Yes, you can see a demo. Let me just throw that, finish this little bit here. And you shall see the game. So if that values is type float, then e dot no screen shake. So lens push effect lens shake. Sweet, yeah. I just gotta finish this one little thing here. Almost got this done. So lens shake duration strength. Okay, so the duration, oh, we also need to pass in a duration. So duration is going to be 0.5. There we go. We need to make sure we have two values. And then they're both floats. And then we'll get them both. Nice. Okay, so pushing back a lens shake. And this is B values 1 dot as float and B values 2 dot as float. I got enough parentheses there. What's the problem? Let's see here. No viable conversion from. Oh, this is supposed to be new lens shake. All right, and that just returns true so that it continues the sequence. So I've been working on this new AI system. It's compiling now that runs everything off of these scripts, behavior trees. So this is kind of what it looks like. Yeah, cool. So they did the screen shake now. Boom. With a nice like sound effect, that'll be pretty cool. So this game is pretty much like a Zelda-like game. In fact, let me turn off the forcing of it to be all the same enemy so you can see that some other enemies and some other randomness. So I'm going to turn off that force, and then also I'm going to turn off the force of this. Sweet. Yeah, right, Zeth? It worked on the first try. So cool when things work on the first try. And now that the system is like this, a lot of these things are working on the first try. So these enemies are called the Drobth. They're pretty, like, intense guys here. The intelligence of enemies is pretty low right now because this is level 1. But at full intelligence, these guys are hard. So there's those guys. There's these new guys that shake the screen and they're like little spring traps. There's some blob enemies we've got in the game so far. These little bats, I gotta do them next. They should be a really easy AI to do. Oh, this is the boss screen right here. Totally rough sketch art right there. Nice. Thank you. Yeah. So I'll show you one more thing. What was that? Oh, well, if you, like, this is how the AI works. It's all in a behavior tree. So it's really not that hard to implement. So behavior trees, if you just search for behavior trees online, you'll find some info on those. But they are, once they're written, dude, it's like the most nice and powerful and simple system ever. So this is how that bouncing pulverizer AI works right there. Yeah, it probably does double shake. That's pretty good insight. But yeah, so this is how simple it is. All it does is a sequence. So like a sequence will run everything beneath it until one of them fails. A select will run one of anything that's in there until one succeeds. Nice, Mishra, you learned something today. Cool. So that's just how it works. It's basically scripted AI. Yeah, let's make a sound effect, actually. I've got a cool explosion for this other game I wrote, but actually I'm going to go try to find a new explosion noise. Actually, I'm going to go and sample that other explosion noise and see if it's something I can work really fast into this game. So I wrote this game called Hero Bash, and I did all the sound effects for it. So I'm going to dig into those sounds I did for that. Because I remember I wrote, there's a really cool explosion noise in here. I think it was called Explosion, one of these explosions. I've made all this art. This is all pixel art I've done. I do it in Photoshop. So for example, the Drobth guy is the most recent piece of art. And I just basically started doing the enemies really recently. So, where is he at? Foes. Drobth. So they're really, really scaled, really small because, you know, it's pixel art. And I just like drew this guy in his first frame and then animated him into all the other frames, threw him in the game. That's how it's all is getting in here. So I'm going to turn down my sound so it's not too loud for you guys. No, it's not that one. No. 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 It's called Rock something. Yeah, if you want to learn how to make art and you're just getting started, I actually wrote a series about that. So it's on Wizard Foo. Actually, if you just search for From Programmer to Artist, there's a series I just did of, it's a short little series, like each video is only 5 minutes long, but it's about how to become an artist. Because I've primarily been a programmer for most of my game development years. And recently I learned how to do art, so. Oh, that was it. Nice. This one's pretty cool. So, what's that? I understand making personalities for different AIs. The movement and analyzing that's an issue. Oh, yeah. Yep. Yeah, and you're welcome. I hope that helps. It's really, for me, it was about believing I could. Because at first I was like, there's no way I can ever become an artist. You know, I had become a programmer. I'd become a musician, too. But I had never been an artist until very, very recently. Yeah, this is a sweet noise. But it sounds a lot like an explosion. Yeah, actually, a lot of people are the other way around. They do art, but they don't do programming. So maybe, you know, maybe it helps to have somebody like this to watch doing live stuff. Still waiting for anybody to reply on that thread, but... Okay, so explosion... If this is the way... I think if it were a little shorter, it might actually work, but I might need to grab a whole new effect for this. So I'm going to do something like maybe about that long, and then something like that. Oh, can't find the thread? Sorry about that. So you go to forums.tigsource.com and then go to devlogs. And it's just called Songbringer. So Devlogs is right on the main TIGSource forums. Whoops. You're starting get a sketchbook first? Yeah. Nice. Yeah, that's what I got too. I got a bamboo to start with. So here it is. It's yeah, you just go to TIGSource forums. And then Devlogs, and then Songbringer. Yeah. Oh, cool. Oh, great. Yeah, so there it is. It's in here, Songbringer. So I don't know about this sound. So this one had a nice like intro to it, but this is gonna be like a like things just making RTS. Cool, man. RTS is sweet. Oh yeah, that's one way to do it. That's cool. RTS is a great genre to do. Yeah, see, there we go. Now this sound is a bit sculpted, and it's actually sounding all right. I'm going to throw this in the game, so at least there's something when those pulverizers hit each other. So we're going to go AF. Pulverizer hit. Oh, nice. That's great. I hear those sell really, really well, too. And they're just cool to be able to do for kids, you know? So, asset sounds cool. Now we can hook it up to the profile in... Pulverizer. So you have a sound. Sounds, hurt, release, bounce. I think this is when I'll call it bounce. And then this is going to be pulverizer hit. Okay, so now the AI needs a way that it can actually play sounds. Nice. I'm really stoked to add this bit too. So this is going to be K behavior. Sound. Yep. Okay, that's all we need there. So when they bounce, screen shake, sound, sound bounce. Okay, so gotta hook this into the component so it can recognize that word. So this is gonna be sound and K behavior sound. And then in the system, if it gets that K behavior sound, it'll play one of the sounds from the profile. Oh yeah, this is C++ as well. So this is C++. I'm using the engine Cocos2DX. And of course, on top of that, I've written my own game engine basically for this game. It's specific for that. And I'm using an entity component system for the whole game. And I do plan on releasing it on GitHub as soon as I do this one last bit of optimization to it. So, because it's really, really, really helped me to be able to do an entity, like all these components and entities and stuff. It just like really simplifies the way games are. And it's cool to be able to add and remove components live, you know, and as the game runs. So I really recommend using an ECS for sure. So, okay, so this is going to be if K behavior sound. And B dot values that size. It's greater than zero. No, greater than, yeah, just greater than zero. And then, and B values, need to make sure the value is a string. So this is B to values zero, get type is K value type string. Cool. What's up, Mr. Burrito? ECS. Yeah, it stands for Entity Component System. It's kind of like Unity. If you use Unity, everything is a component. You add a component to entities. An entity basically in my game is just an integer. It's just an ID number. And then components, you add to an entity. And so each entity has like a, yeah, like a profile component, render component, shadow component, position component, input component, move component, collision, health, melee, AI, everything can be componentized. Oh yeah, it's probably just my naming system. Everybody's kind of got their own unique names for stuff. So then we're gonna go e.profile.profile.playSound, b.values0 dot as string. There we go. So that should hook up that part. Okay. Let's hope that plays that sound. If it works on the first try, that'll be the second thing that worked on the first try today. Nice, it did. Oh, but they didn't turn around because I forgot to return true. So this is going to be right here. I go return true. So make sure to continue the sequence. So it didn't quite work on the first try. So can the game look at the components with accessor methods to see position and other data? Yes. So that any bit of the game. For example, I could be anywhere in the code, and if I have the ID for an entity, so if an entity ID is like one or whatever, I can do entity get, say I wanted to get the shadow component. I go get shadow component for that ID, and I have it. And this is an automatic reference as well, so shadow equals this. And then I can go shadow dot sprite dot whatever, do whatever with it. So it makes things really, really accessible and very organized. Oh, yeah. Oh, are you talking about C++11 and the stuff you're not quite understanding? It's definitely worth learning. Okay, so let's check if that works. Now that that returns true, it'll continue the sequence, and then it should keep these guys from getting stuck. Nice. Sweet. Okay. So one thing though, I want this sound effect to be a little longer, just a tiny bit. So, that was about there. First, I'm going to take off this front bit. Okay, I'm going to try doing this much taken off. And then it needs to be kind of a nice tail like that. That sounds better. Cool. Well, some of the things in C++ 11 make things a lot more simple. Like, check this out, FateSword. If you're doing a for loop in old school C++, you're going to do something like this. For int, int I equals 0, I is less than 10, I plus plus, do some stuff. You know, that took a while to type in, right? In C++ 11, there's a new way of doing things. So if you have like a vector, so you have like a vector container of integers, vector v, you can do this. You can loop over every bit, every item in that container, just like that simple. It's simplified for loops, for auto, you know. So there's a lot of cool things to check out, really. And auto is an awesome keyword too. So instead of like in C++, old school, you would have to do, like let's say I had a sprite pointer, s equals null. But in C++ 11, you don't have to declare things as they always are. You can do auto s equals say sprite create, and it automatically knows the type. Why is that failing for me? Oh, because I just redefined s. Okay. So yeah, basically, you can automatically define types. You can use what's called lambda functions, which are super awesome. So definitely some things there that like could make things easier for you to code with. I definitely recommend learning. Okay, so let's get this effect exported out into the game and see if it sounds better now that it has a tiny bit more of a tail. Yeah, that's awesome. Sweet. Oh, I got hit. Okay, cool. I'm liking these guys a lot. But I want them to be cooler. I want to draw them nicer. So, I'm going to grab this pulverizer guy. The first thing I want them to be able to do is hover in the air. I'm gonna grab my art pen. Why is that sad? Oh, you mean it's an older C++? Oh, I see what you're saying. Do we got any replies yet? Come on, come on, come on. Nice. Thanks, Faux Fox. Nice, I'll reply in a second. So yeah, let's draw these guys better. So right now they're like this, and I'm gonna save this as pulverizer idle. So the first thing that's gonna be really, really easy to do is just giving them a, oh cool, it's you? Nice. Thank you. Thanks for replying to my thread. I feel validated. That's a pretty programmery thing to say, right? Okay. I'm going to take off these backgrounds. I don't need all those. So getting this guy just to hover in the air is super simple. And I can also do a few more frames on here. I want his red stuff to glow a bit. Special? Yes, exactly. Oh man, you got me there. Special. Okay, so this guy, I want him to glow and hover. So I'm gonna make his little... Actually, the first thing, maybe I'll make him just look cooler. They should have like come some kind of red eye or something. Yeah, it's this. This he'll have like this red little thing, and it'll glow when he starts to do his animation. So I'm gonna get a little bit of a darker color. A little bit darker than that. Yeah. All right. So this is going to be black while he's... Well, he's like inactive, just sitting there. So he's gonna be like this. And then when it wakes up, I wonder if it looks better with a little bit of that. No. It's pretty cool like that. Okay, so I want this color to be even blacker. Try almost full black. Yeah, that's it. That kind of gives it a feeling like it's just deep, for sure. A deep enemy. So, I might try doing a tiny bit of hue. Actually, this purple hue is actually pretty nice. Green, no. No, I think in purple actually was kind of cool. Yeah, just a slight bit of color. Exactly, right? Okay, so then I'm gonna merge these layers. Yeah, just a slight bit of hue to that really helps. And then this one, I'm going to grab that color, duplicate this guy again. Actually, I'm just going to do a new layer, draw this little red light eye thing, and then give it some blur. So filter blur, Gaussian blur. Okay, I'm going to grab another layer. This is like the easiest enemy to animate in the world. Okay, so that red needs to be way more vivid. Thinking just like, bam. Yeah, and then maybe it has like some... So some like data processing or something going on in it. Looking like this. And then this bit, I'm going to duplicate this a few more times to bring up this glow. There, now I've got a few glow layers I can play with when I animate it. Okay, I'm going to make a few more data layers as well. So start with, oh, I need to turn off these glow layers. Okay, so this, I got that color and this color. Make maybe two more layers like this. Right, now I've got a lot of stuff to play with to animate this guy. This thing, whatever it is. Okay. Now, a simple hover. This is like the easiest thing in the world. They're hovering so happy. Less jovial, for sure. We want like a little more time to hover. More relaxed. Even more. Okay, we can track 0.4 seconds each. Man, I guess a half second. Oops. Yeah, that's about right. Okay, so we've got some frames we can export out here for his idle. This is pulverizer idle sheets foes pulverizer idle 0. Oh, that was 1. Okay, this one's 0. There's 1, 2, and 3. All right, now I want to do another animation for this guy. We'll call this Pulverizer Seek. This one is going to be hovering. But the data is going to be shown, so. And then it's just going to be as easy as showing more layers. Oh, dang. You must have 2010. There we go. Yeah, totally. I think Visual Studio 2010 is the one that didn't have much C++ 11 support. I think it did have a little, but not everything you'd need. Oh, okay, so these glows. There we go. That looks better. All right, let's see how this guy looks. Okay, so when he gets excited like this and he detects the human, he needs to hover a lot faster. That might work like that. Okay, if not, I'll add some more frames. But I'm going to try it out in the game. So this is Seek 0. Oh, dang, that was Seek 3. Okay, Seek 0. Oh, man, I named this thing wrong. Pulverizer Seek. Oh. Ah. Seek 2. Seek 3. All right, so now adding these into this guy's property list. So it loads these animations. We got pulverizer idle percent %d. This has a delay of 0.5. Frame count. Was it 3, 4? I think it was 4. Yeah, they both have 4. Okay, and then this is very similar. This animation, this is going to be called run because that's what any AI uses when it's moving. So this was a much faster hover, so 0.25. And then going here, Seek. Okay, that should do it. Let's see.
Baby?
Yeah.
Are you streaming?
Yeah.
Hi, everybody. About you leftover Thai food.
Oh, whoa, nice. Cool, I'm hungry. All right, nice. These guys look great. They light up red when they're moving. They're active. I'd like to see them do a little spin around kind of move. Like, maybe when they get all the way back, they'll spin. Yeah, these guys are way cooler when they're more brought to life like this with these cool animations. Nice. All right. Oops. Thanks for replying, Vesvon. Okay. Here's the cheers. Totally doing the cheers beer icon on you. Oh. Who's that? Who do you mean? You mean on here on this forum or on, that was my girlfriend, you mean, that just came in? Yeah. I'm 35 years old. Should have a girlfriend by now. Okay, so yeah. Oh, one last thing. I want this guy to be able to spin around. That'll be really cool. Thinking either dark or whether to spin him around while he's dark or while he's lit up. Probably while he's dark. So I'm gonna go save as. Call this idle 2. Can always make this a lit up as well later. So I'm gonna delete all these frames. Probably gonna be about 0.1 seconds to animate this. And I'm thinking 1, 2, 3. 4 frames probably ought to do it for this guy to just spin around. So I'm going to start with this frame 2. I'm actually going to turn this into these kind of deformation things, and oh, does this warp not do? This might be not what I wanted. Yeah, no, I'm just gonna have to draw this by hand. Okay. Actually, so this will squeeze a bit. Like that. What's up at Tech Studios? Which part's fancy? Here we go. One more. Oh. Okay, come on. Must be bicubic. Oh, sweet. Thanks, man. This is just this pulverizer guy. So this pulverizer guy there's this new AI in here that, it's called a behavior tree. So I wrote it during yesterday's live stream. So these pulverizer guys, they're okay. But I want them to spin around a little bit too when they hit things. So these guys are pretty cool too. These guys are the drop enemies. Pretty hard. So just working on some art right now. Thanks, man. Thank you. Thanks for the love. So this guy, I'm going to animate him so he spins around. And I'm going to add that as like a second idle animation. So while he's sitting there, sometimes he'll just spin around. And that'll give him just a little more life. Oh. So what happened to my controls? They're gone. Show. It's not extras. I want to stretch this. Oh, because I'm on the wrong layer. Okay, there we go. All right, so I'm going to squeeze that in a little bit like that, and then, oh man, I did it again. So I'm trying to do this squeeze. Okay. But Photoshop is messing with me. There, I need nearest neighbor. Okay, I wonder if I can actually do 3D mode with nearest neighbor. Oh, I can. Okay, cool. That's all I wanted this whole time. Okay, starting over. Duplicate layer one. Grab this and make sure it's nearest neighbor, and then do this 3D deformation thing. So that's a little bit too much on the sides of the vector there. Oh, well, no worries, man. You don't need to learn C++ 11. You can stick with C++ as you got it. Yeah, that's a good suggestion. It's kind of a wonky angle. Hey, good for you, a test at Tech Studios. I'm glad people are learning C++. Because most people are learning like C sharp, doing development with like Unity and stuff like that. And that's a great language to learn too. But I've always loved C++. I think it's cool other people are learning it. It's the most portable language there is. It's super universal. It's never gone away in so many years of development. It's got a lot going for it. Oh, sweet. Oh, I didn't know Unreal was C++. Gotta get hip to the engines. Well, Visual Studio 13 does have C++ 11 in it. Oh, really? Oh, cool. Wow. Okay, so that's a bit wonky, but it's hard to do anything too accurately with pixel art sometimes. So I'm going to go to the next frame. This one, it's about halfway through its little rotation, and then it's gonna be a little bit, dang it, why did it do that? What's up, Hira? OpenGL, it's not too hard. It's really C-based. If you're familiar with the C language, there's nothing object-oriented about OpenGL. It's all functions and pushing things on the stacks and stuff. And it's pretty, if you jive with how it works, you'll get it pretty fast. Yeah, exactly. If you're comfortable with linear algebra, definitely shouldn't be too bad. You know what? To hell with this. Stretching it that way. I'm just going to stretch it this way. And then shift things up. Like this. That actually looks all right. Oh, good. You're going to love OpenGL then. Definitely. Okay, now that works so much easier to just like shift these up one row of pixels at a time. So I'm going to duplicate this. I'm going to put it over here, flip it over. And then this layer, I'm going to lighten just a little bit, or darken. Maybe I'll darken it just lightly. Image adjustments, brightness, here we go. So just darkening it just a tad bit, like that. And then I'm gonna put it below this other layer. Yeah, okay, that works. All right, merging these. This thing's top color is about this, about like that. So it's too stretched. Needs one more pixel on either side. Well, that's probably a compliment. If you're writing procedural code that's class-based, that's a good thing. It seems that way. Because then you're thinking in a kind of an object-oriented way. You totally can do that. You can code in pure C in a pretty, you know, object-oriented style without having to really use objects. You can kind of make things object-y, sort of. Okay, I don't know if I'm happy with that frame. So I'm going to delete that and start that one over. This one. Squish it down. Like 80%, that's good. And I'm going to shift it up a little bit. Maybe halfway through, like about there. Okay, I'm gonna undo that. I'm gonna do 75%. There we go, and then I'm gonna duplicate this first layer again. Stretch this one down to 25%. And darken it slightly. Yes, essentially, yeah, it's totally part of everything. It's part of the actual core C++11 language. And all it means is that it gets the type for you without you having to declare it. So instead of having to type car, you actually type auto. And whatever that variable is, it just knows what it is. I hope that makes sense. It basically makes you be able to program lazy. Yeah, exactly. Massey. What's up, Massey? So, stoked to have the new website done, songbringer.com, and stoked to have a post up on forums.tigsource. So if you guys are visiting TigSource in the near future, I put up a devlog. So it's in TigSource, devlogs, and then just go to Songbringer and That's where the post is. Ruby. I guess, I don't know if Ruby does that. I haven't tried it. So, Massey, your recommendations earlier this week were fundamental to what actually happened this week. So you said, why don't you develop, use behavior trees and check it out. Got behavior trees written into the game. So this is the AI for the pulverizer that I'm making right now. And everything uses behavior trees. So these guys use behavior trees now. So when you were watching earlier this week, these guys did not use behavior trees and they were a lot more dumb. Now they're a lot smarter. And if I set their intelligence higher, they become incredibly difficult enemies to fight, actually. So if I set the intelligence all the way at maximum, these guys just like will work you super fast. Oh yeah, you were telling me about him and how his live stream is a big influence. Oh, what's up? Why aren't they intelligent? Oh, because there's a slight random factor to their intelligence too. They're not always perfectly intelligent. So yeah, this is them at their maximum intelligence. They're just like on you like flies. And then so this AI too, right here, these pulverizers are actually written with the same kind of system too. It's like all based on that. And also your recommendation to check out that one video. What was that one video you recommended? It was about adding like a 50 millisecond delay and everything. That really helped too. So I added a delay when you connect with enemies. There's brightness, there's like screen shakes and stuff. So thank you for the recommendations because that's going really, really well. Yeah, the Vlambeer guy, totally. Yeah, so we'll leave their intelligence all the way up for right now. And I just wanted to finish this one animation today. Just this guy, he's going to twist around. Just a total like little flare. It's not even going to do anything in the game. It's just, it's just going to be visual. So we got this frame, this frame, this frame. This one, actually, I'm going to move down a pixel. And this one down maybe 2 pixels. So there's that. Well, yeah, I mean, if you want to be explicit about all your variables and always type there what they are, you can't do that. And that's true. Massey has a good point. And when you're using auto, it's not as readable sometimes. Well, I think that's debatable, but one disadvantage actually is that you don't know the type. So, it's kind of a debate, but you can look at it either way. So if you prefer to not use auto, then don't, and you probably don't even want to learn C++ 11 then, because a lot of that stuff is just the same kind of stuff, makes things lazier for you. Okay, so this last frame here, similar to this frame. Actually, it's almost exactly like this frame. So I'm just gonna flip this over. Mm-hmm, it's true. When you're looking at the code later, sometimes it can be more helpful to actually have all your types declared explicitly. There we go, I think that's all. Okay. Oops. Okay, so gonna do set up these frames and see how this animation looks. What's up, Paul Six? Paul Six, I'll show you. I was just showing these guys too, but the game now has behavior trees for the AI. So this is like the behavior for the polarizer. It uses this, like, this is a tree, and then it runs the sequences or selects, and then these are like the leaves of the tree and the actions that it takes and things like that. So what that did is it made it so the enemies are a lot smarter, basically, and the system of the AI is a lot cooler. So in the future, I can write way more customized AIs. So like these guys are just a lot smarter and more aggressive now. And they also have an intelligence factor. So like these guys can be super intelligent or they can be super dumb. And then, so now I'm working on this little AI for these pulverizer guys. They're just like, they're like the traps in Zelda 1. And I'm just doing one more little animation for them to kind of finish them out for the day. And all you guys, if you haven't seen, I'm promoting this like crazy because I'm seeking validation. Basically, I put up a forum post on forums at TigSource. So if you're on TigSource at all and you feel like commenting or whatever, there's TigSource forums. You go to the devlogs, and then Songbringer now has a post up. So great. So now we got this finished. Wait, let's see how it looks first, actually. Okay, so that middle frame is like a little bit too much. Yeah, forums at TigSource is a good one to have an account for. I'm finding a lot of people. I'm just so humbled by it, how many great developers are on there. Awesome games too, and great stories. Like the story of Moon Man is amazing. That guy's been working on that game for so long, and it's great to see his Kickstarter success now. And I'm just really proud of so many other developers. And TigSource seems to be a great place to meet other developers and other gamers. Okay, so this edge right here, that's the problem. This bit is a little bit too much. And this, okay, so these, move this like that. See how that looks. Still kind of lumpy. But I could smooth it out a bit. I noticed this top color needs to be just right. All right, so one of the issues here is that it grows in width. So what is it at first? It's like 13 pixels wide, and then here it's 14 pixels wide, so that's an issue. And it needs more of its... So this one's definitely way too wide. What's this one? 15, and it's supposed to be 13. Yeah, so this one needs to come in 2 pixels, and I see the pixel I want to take away. So those that way. And then making this top just a little bit more clean. Cool, man. Good luck with your game, your RTS, and good luck with coding and everything. This has actually turned out to be a difficult thing to animate in pixel art. Something like this, a little tiny 3D object rotating. You didn't learn Photoshop? Did you learn something else? Like a different art tool or something? Now it's messed up again. So this frame, I'm gonna try and move up these pixels. No, that's wrong. Oh yeah, well, I mean, if you're comfortable with a different tool, I wouldn't even switch. It's like the time it takes to learn a tool is sometimes can be really time consuming. Just that. Okay, I'm not sure if this is going to get that much better today. So I'm just gonna throw this in the game and see what it looks like. I'm not sure if I'm happy with it, but at least we can see what it looks like. And then move on to some other AI later tonight. But that said, I am actually almost done with my live stream for today. Tired of sitting down, gotta take a break, gotta get some dinner. All right, okay, we got those in, and then we just hook it up to his profile. Resprite, huh? Check that out. Sweet. This looks pretty awesome. Nice. I might check that out. But I am liking Photoshop. Just, I might stick with what I know. Okay, this is Idle 2. Idle 2, frame count, 4. Now, the AI getting it to run a different idle animation. No, yeah, Cocos actually handles parsing of the property lists. Yep. I think it does rely on objective, like Coco, Objective-C type functions underneath to actually parse it, at least on iOS and Mac, but on Android, it actually does go through and parse it like XML. But yeah, I think that just does. It just treats it as XML. It might even do that on Mac and iOS these days. But back in the day, I know it used to use open Cocoa functions. Okay, so this last thing, the system, render system, get idle, anim key. All right, this is return idle. All right, so this is the thing. If any render component e.profile.is, so if it has a profile and it has an idle to animation, e.profile.animation for key idle to return idle to. And it has to be a random chance that's pretty small. So rand f01 is less than, say, 10% of the time. So 10% of the time, if it has an idle to animation, it'll run the idle to. That might be too much, but I'll try it. I don't see any of them doing it. Maybe I did it the wrong way. No, randf01 is a function of that I wrote. It's really simple. It's just an inline function that does rand mod the rand max over the rand max. So just gives me a floating point random number between 0 and 1. Yeah, you typed it right before I said it. Or you probably were typing it before I said it, is what I meant. Okay, so why? Oh, sweet. Do you name it exactly the same, randf01? So if I name this something wrong and then run it, it should fail. Okay, it didn't fail. Oh, because there's no pulverizers. Okay, there. Yes, okay, so it failed. So I am loading the right frames. Oh, okay. Cool. Oh, okay. Everybody's got their own ways of doing things. Pulverizer idle too. So if I take out this random component, maybe that's the issue. Oh, okay. So the initial animation that it started. Okay, so yeah, that was the issue. It starts with a certain animation and it just loops that forever. Oh, so that's going to have to be a little bit different. So So I think it might get stuck looping forever. Yeah, I think I'm gonna have to just finish just the last little bit of code later. So, because I am sore, I gotta get going. So, once again, thank you all. Thank you so much. Seriously, some of your, the best suggestions for this game have come from this chat window right here, from all y'all telling, making suggestions. Yesterday, one of the greatest suggestions was, why don't you make your this little thing, instead of making it a property list, which was super convoluted, or JSON, which was also convoluted, they're like, why don't you make your own? Actually, yeah, some rooms you'll be able to leave before killing all the enemies, and some rooms you won't. So for now, though, they're all just allowing you to leave. The doors don't lock, except for this one boss room I've created. So, yeah, so that'll be dependent on the random generation of the levels and stuff. Yeah, looking forward to next time, too. And once again, thank you for pointing out, like, for example, to check out those cool videos and do those behavior trees. Things have really improved. A lot of it's thanks to you guys, so appreciate it. Thanks a lot, you guys. Check y'all later. If you get a chance and you're on TickSource, too, check out my thread. That's it. Later.